41 to 51. Luke chapter 2, verses 41 to 51. We first of all read the reference through, and then we'll study the way in which Christ manifested a spirit of obedience and a spirit of faith throughout this experience. Luke chapter 2, we'll start with verse 41. Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. And when they had fulfilled the days, as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother knew not of it. But they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day's journey, and they sought him amongst their kinsfolk and acquaintance. And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. And it came to pass that after 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And he said to them, How is it that you sought me? Wist you not that I must be about my father's business? And they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject unto them. And his mother kept all these sayings in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Now notice that the parents of Christ went down to the Passover every year, but not till the age of 12 did he accompany them. That was the standard custom in the economy of Israel. And some comments on this in the book Desire of Ages helps to clarify that point, page 75. Among the Jews, the 12th year was a dividing line between childhood and youth. On completing this year, a Hebrew boy was called a son of the law and also a son of God. He was given special opportunities for religious instructions and was expected to participate in the sacred feasts and observances. It was in accordance with this custom that Jesus in his boyhood made the Passover visit to Jerusalem. Like all devout Israelites, Joseph and Mary went up every year to attend the Passover, and when Jesus had reached the required age, they took him with them. There were 3 annual feasts, the Passover, Pentecost, and Feast of Tabernacles, but this, of course, was the one that dealt with the Feast of the Passover. Now let's pass on to page 78, if you have the book, page 78 in this same book, Desire of Ages. I am not concerned, of course, with every detail of this history. I am concerned with Christ's relationship to the principles of obedience and the principles of faith. Because we're studying Christ now not as a prophet, not as a teacher, but as what?
Child.
Yes, as a child, sure, but that's not quite what I'm looking for. As the Holy One, right, as the Holy One. For what purpose? So we shall understand exactly what holiness is, or holy living is, and therefore shall know how to develop the experience of a Philadelphian, right? Now Jesus Christ, of course, is the perfect example in this respect, and I still am hopeful that you really got the point yesterday when we looked at the story of Jacob's trouble and saw how that not until the end of that time will we have come to the place where every trace of the old spirit of human plan making, every trace of earthliness will have been removed from us. In other words, not till then will we have come to the place where at last we'll know what true obedience is and true faith really will be. So now, I come now to page 78, and we're looking, as I said, at the life of Christ as the Holy One and therefore as the obedient and faith-filled one. For the first time, the child Jesus looked upon the temple. He saw the white-robed priest performing their solemn ministry. He beheld the bleeding victim upon the altar of sacrifice. With the worshippers he bowed in prayer while the cloud of incense ascended before God. He witnessed the impressive rites of the Paschal service. Day by day he saw their meaning more clearly. Every act seemed to be bound up with his own life. New impulses were awakening within him. Silent and absorbed, he seemed to be studying out a great problem. The mystery of his mission was opening to the Saviour. Right, now this paragraph tells us that as Jesus Christ went down to the Passover service, for the first time he looked upon some very, very impressive scenes. The ministry of the priests, the sacrifice being offered, the rituals being performed, and as he saw these things, there seemed to be something very familiar about them. Now, Christ was now 12 years of age, and as we know, of course, he'd been waxing strong in spirit and in favor with God and man. During those previous years, there had been not the slightest turning aside in the sin in his life, because he was the sinless one who maintained his spotless integrity. And as we know, Christ had beheld the love of God and the power of God both in nature and in the written word. He was familiar with the sacrificial service in theory. He also knew the prophecy which related to his own divine mission. And so as he beheld this scene, it seemed familiar to him, and he began to recognize the relationship between what those things pictured and his own mission. As the statement says, the mystery of his mission began to unfold to the Savior. Now, I feel a very close relationship to Christ at this moment, because during this week, as we have been studying not just this week either, but during the previous years, as we've been studying the great messages of God's character and Sabbath rest and the seven angels, what has been opening up to us? The mystery of our mission. The picture of why we're in this world. What are we here for? We're not here just to get to heaven. We're here to be God's instruments for the final, complete revelation of his character, by which the man of sin shall experience his final and total defeat. And therefore, as the mystery of Christ's mission opened up before him, as he saw in those sacrifices the spirit of total submissiveness to complete sacrifice, so likewise we have been seeing the same principles as we looked at the Philadelphian Church, and we're learning the kind of obedience that God will accept, the kind of obedience where we do things God's way under God's personal direction, and we never ever make the least attempt to build our own kingdom or empire. Now, I'm much impressed to read a statement which I just can't find again. It's quoted there in the editorial in a recent Messenger magazine, I think about 2 or 3 months ago. Now, remember by quoting it there, if you read the Messenger faithfully, I hope you do. Otherwise, I shan't send it. And the statement talked about the angels up in heaven 10,000 times 10,000, thousands of thousands who wait to do his bidding. And that really...
Mm-hmm. SDA Bible Commentary 7, 9:33.
Thank you very much. I'll now we've got to relocate it. I'll read it and I'll keep a note of it in future so I don't forget it again. Volume 7, page 933. I beg your pardon. I thought you said 973.
I could have.
I just misheard you, I'm sure. Okay, now the statement 933. Yes, here it is. No. Yep, this is it. From Hebrew, it's a comment on Hebrews 10 and verse 19. Do not let your thoughts dwell upon yourselves. Think of Jesus. He is in his holy place, not in a state of solitude and grandeur, but surrounded by 10,000 times 10,000 of heavenly beings who wait to do their master's bidding. And he bids them go and work for the weakest saint who puts his trust in God. High and low, rich and poor, have the same help provided. Now, when I think of an angel, and what a powerful, talented, capable being that angel is, I marvel at their spirit of service. Now, the angels have lived for how long? Possibly billions of years. We don't know, of course. We know this earth is only 6,000 years of age. We don't agree with the evolutionistic theories about the earth being billions of years old. But the angels of God were in heaven long before there were any beings upon this earth, right? Long, long before. Now they have at least 20 times the electrical energy in their brains that we've got, 20 times at least the mental capacity is. And you just stop and think of what you could do if you had twice your present mental capacity, or even only 10% more. How about 20 times what you now have? And during those, and of course they have boundless energy, they never get tired. And imagine what angels must be like after billions of years of development with that kind of brain power to begin with and with unlimited energy to go on with, and direct access, of course, to all the revelations of God up in heaven above. Now, what could those angels do by way of personal projects, personal business interests, if they wish to? But they lay all that aside, because their one consuming interest is the right to do the bidding of our Lord Jesus Christ. And what a spirit of service it is. And certainly, of course, there's a picture of total dedication to the cause of God. Now, coming back then to the ministry of Jesus Christ, as the mystery was missioned open before him, he then began to understand in very clear terms, or clearer terms still, that this mission would require a spirit of total dedication to and obedience of every command as it came from God. He would have to do God's work as God planned it should be done. Not as he might think it ought to be done, but as God planned it should be done. Let's go across to page 208 for a moment in the book Desire of Ages again. And here are some comments which you recognize, of course, as being quite truthful in regard to the building of the Old Testament sanctuary. Page 208 in the book Desire of Ages. The last paragraph which crosses the page to page 209. When Moses was about to build the sanctuary as a dwelling place for God, he was directed to make all things according to the pattern shown him in the mount. Moses was full of zeal to do God's work. The most talented, skillful men were at hand to carry out his suggestions. Yet he was not to make a bell, a pomegranate, a tassel, a fringe, a curtain, or any vessel of the sanctuary, except according to the pattern shown him. God called him to the mount and revealed to him the heavenly things. The Lord covered him with his own glory, that he might see the pattern, and according to it all things were made. So to Israel, whom he desired to make his dwelling place, he had revealed his glorious ideal of character. The pattern was shown them in the mount when the law was given from Sinai. And when the Lord passed by before Moses and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, giving mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. Exodus 34, 6 and 7. Now here, first of all, is a contrast between the building of the sanctuary and the proposed character building in ancient Israel. Now the sanctuary was quite a complex building. It had beautifully worked images in the form of cherubims and altars and tables for the showbread and so forth and candlesticks. And Moses was filled with zeal to do this work for God, and Moses could very easily decide he could, well, just improve the picture here and there. Make this a little prettier and add a few flowers and whatever else it might be somewhere else. But he was commanded to build everything in that building how? As it was shown to him in the mount. And how much human planning, how much human devising was there in that design? None. Not one thread of human devising, as you read in Christ of His Lessons, page 311. Yeah, page 311. Not one thread of human devising was permitted in that building. So likewise, Israel was to introduce no human plan making into their character development. That was entirely and only God's business. But the next sentence says on page 209, Israel had chosen their own ways. They had not builded according to the pattern, but Christ, the true temple for God's indwelling, molded every detail of his earthly life in harmony with God's ideal. That's why it's so important to look away from our own ideas and theories and to give up our own versions of how things ought to be and say, now, what does God say it shall be? And pattern our lives by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That's the only safety. When I find a person arise who begins to say, well, I can believe 90% of the spirit of prophecy or 50% of it, but there are some things where I just can't go along with that and the Bible too. Or when people decide that they're going to build their own message and movement or whatever, apart from what God is doing, then what are they doing? They're building, but not according to the pattern. And if the Lord doesn't build the house, then what about it? They labor in vain to build it. And there's no lesson more important than to be submissive to what God is doing, as Jesus Christ was submissive to what his Father was doing back there in his earthly ministry. Now, the parents of Jesus Christ did not share the understanding which he obtained at the Passover service. They'd been there before. They could see nothing more than a dead, cold ritual. They were largely disinterested in it. They went through the motions, but so far as participation in the spirit of it was concerned, they just were not with it. And they were therefore more concerned with having a happy social time with cousins and uncles and brothers and sisters and friends and acquaintances and fellow church members. And consequently, of course, the disparity of interest led them in one direction and Christ in a different direction, and so a physical separation took place between the two parties. Now, the parents of Jesus, of course, did not notice his absence from them because they were so happy and contented with their own social relationships. And Jesus Christ gravitated to one of the quiet rooms where the learned minds of Israel conducted a school every time the Passover convened, to make the most of the opportunity of developing the young minds of the young Jews who came to the temple. Now Christ sat down with these men. As I now read, it says, seating himself, this is page 78, Desire of Ages, seating himself at the feet of these grave, learned men, he listened to their instruction. As one seeking for wisdom, he questioned these teachers in regard to the prophecies and to events that then taking place that pointed to the advent of the Messiah. Jesus presented himself as one thirsting for knowledge of God. His questions were suggestive of deep truth which had long been obscured, yet which were vital to the salvation of souls. While showing how narrow and superficial was the wisdom of the wise men, every question put before them a divine lesson and placed truth in a new aspect. The rabbi spoke of the wonderful elevation which the Messiah's coming would bring to the Jewish nation, but Jesus presented the prophecy of Isaiah and asked them the meaning of those scriptures which point to the suffering and death of the Lamb of God. The doctors turned upon him with questions, and they were amazed at his answers. With the humility of a child, he repeated the words of Scripture, giving them a depth of meaning that the wise had not conceived of. If followed, the lines of truth he pointed out would have worked a reformation in the religion of the day. A deep interest in spiritual things would have been awakened, and when Jesus began his ministry, many would have been prepared to receive him. And very obviously, of course, God was the plan maker of these events in the life of Christ. Christ did not plan himself to go into this room with those men, but God led him there, and when he got there, of course, God guided his mind as to what he should ask and what he should say. And what was the result? Success, right? He was successful in stirring up the minds of those men to realize something of the true import of those scriptures. And of course, he also demonstrated in a marvelous way the unbelievable development of the physical, mental, and moral spiritual powers in that child. Now, a very common objection which I find people making is this. They say, well, if I become totally submissive to God's will and let him do all the plan making, the problem solving, and the burden bearing, that means that I do not exercise these God-given qualities myself. Now, God gave me the power to organize. He gave me the power to make plans. He gave me the ability to be a business manager. If I don't exercise these powers and so forth, then I'm going to shrink, I'm going to find my powers becoming obsolete, and I'm going to become less and less and less. Don't you believe it? Because while to human soul it may seem that way, the real facts are that he who lets God be his plan maker and director, the one who works out the life he is to lead, and the one who works in cooperation with God, experiences the very highest possible developments of body, mind, and spirit. Now, when you think about the life of Jesus Christ, during those first 12 years, who had been his plan maker? God the Father. Who had been his teacher? God the Father through the angels. Who had been his problem solver? Once again, God the Father. In other words, Christ had made everything in his life subservient to the will of his Father. He said, what does God want and how does God want it? And that's what I'll give to him. And at the age of 12, was he a retarded child by any means? Anything but. In fact, his mind was so beautifully developed, so powerfully developed, that he could literally, literally, outclass the best brains in the land of Israel. Doctors of the law who are 50, 60, 70, 80 years of age men who are regarded as the wisest and most learned men in Israel, Jesus Christ at the age of 12 could outclass them. Now that was the result of the kind of education which he'd been given, and it was the result of the relationship which Christ sustained toward his heavenly Father. And if we want to develop the highest powers of mind and body, even though from the human point of view it may seem that to become submissive to, excuse me, to God's will excuse me, is to cause us to shrink and be retarded, the real facts are that is the pathway to ultimate success and glory. And the life of Christ proves that point beyond any shadow of doubt. In fact, when you look back through Bible history and find those men like Daniel, and Daniel is an extremely good example of total submission to God's will, then you'll find that Daniel became the mightiest man in all the world at that time, with the most advanced education, the highest intellectual and moral capabilities, and so great was his fame. So great was his fame that the conquering king Darius said, I must have that man to lead my kingdom. Now, have you ever heard of that before, where a conquering nation gives a position to one of the conquered nation? Never. When a conqueror conquers another country and then begins to allot the positions of government, he always gives it to those who together with him gain the victory. Isn't that right? It was a most extraordinary thing for Daniel to be given the top position in the land when he came from the country which had been conquered, and that was one of the reasons, or the biggest reason, why the Persian lords and nobles and so forth were so jealous of Daniel and were so anxious to get rid of him. In the book Ministry of Hearing, page 19, I read these words in regard to Jesus Christ as our example, as both as a child and as a man. In all things he brought his wishes into strict abeyance to his mission. In all things, he glorified his life by making everything in it subordinate to the will of his Father. When in his youth his mother, finding him in the school of the rabbi, said, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? He answered, and his answer is the keynote of his work, how is it that you sought me? Wist you not, or don't you know, that I must be about my Father's business? And if you look in your Bibles again, you'll find that if you go back to Luke, the second chapter, and in verse 48, Mary says to him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And look at that word, father. Now, read to the next verse, verse 49. And he said unto them, how is it that you sought me? Wist you not that I must be about my father's business? Now, you see any difference between the first father and the second father? Yeah. Right. The second one has a capital letter. So when Mary said, thy father, to whom did she make reference? To Joseph. When Christ said, my father's business, to whom did he have reference? God. Right, to God up in heaven above. And small wonder then that when they had in their minds a meaning for the word father, which meant Joseph, and he used the same word with a different meaning altogether, verse 50 says, and they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. Right? Now, coming across to page 81, we find now that as Jesus Christ recognized the mystery of his mission, then he also began to recognize something more in regard to his relationship to his heavenly Father. So read down page 81, the third paragraph. How is it that you sought me, answered Jesus? Wist you not, or better still, don't you know that I must be about my Father's business, or my heavenly Father's business? And as they seemed not to understand these words, he pointed upward. On his face was a light at which they wondered. Divinity was flashing through humanity. On finding him in the temple, they had listened to what was passing between him and the rabbis, and they were astonished at his questions and answers. His words started a train of thought that would never be forgotten. And his question to them had a lesson. Wist you not, he said, that I must be about my Father's business? Jesus was engaged in the work that he had come into the world to do, but Joseph and Mary had neglected theirs. God had shown them high honor in committing to them his son. Holy angels had directed the course of Joseph in order to preserve the life of Jesus, but for an entire day they had lost sight of him whom they should not have forgotten for a moment. And when their anxiety was relieved, they had not censured themselves, but had cast the blame upon him. There's a great lesson to be learned from that thought, but I won't develop that. That's not quite in accepting, of course, to demonstrate that they had forgotten their orders, hadn't they? They had forgotten their orders, and then when they forgot their orders, and that caused separation between them and God, they then turned around and blamed God through Jesus Christ for their troubles, where they should have blamed themselves. And how often this is true when God's people have forgotten their orders and gotten themselves into trouble, then they say, well, Lord, why you let us get into this trouble, when the fault was entirely their own and they should have censured themselves and not God. We now move to the next chapter. The main thought in that one, of course, is the fact that Jesus Christ, having learned the mystery of his mission, then began to follow his heavenly Father's directions more extensively. I'm not suggesting by this, of course, he had not followed them before, but there were more extensive instructions to follow. That's the thought I'm trying to say at that point. Now, the next chapter, I find, is a very important one, because the next chapter brings to view the pressures from every possible direction that are brought to bear upon the child Jesus in an effort on the part of those who are persecuting him to destroy his connection with God and to make him yield to human pressure in the place of divine directions. And this chapter, Days of Conflict, is very, very illuminating in this particular respect. So we start on page 84, and we'll read the first paragraph to begin with. From its earliest years, the Jewish child was surrounded with the requirements of the rabbis. Rigid rules were prescribed for every act down to the smallest details of life. Now let me see the hands of all those who had just loved that kind of childhood. Nothing worse, is there? Rigid rules, right down to the smallest details of life. Is there anything better calculated to destroy the mental, physical and spiritual powers of a person than that? There's nothing. And of course we know that the rigid regulations which the Pharisees imposed upon themselves and upon the people, although of course Christ said to the people that were to do what they say and not what they did in regard to divine principles, but generally speaking, of course, the Pharisees themselves maintained these rigid rules in public but dismissed them when they were in private and out of sight, but they required the people to obey these rigid rules in every particular. Now these rigid rules, of course, did not have in them one thread of divine planning or devising, did they? They were entirely and only from man, and they were administered, of course, by force. I read further. Under the synagogue teachers, the youth were instructed in the countless regulations which, as Orthodox Israelites, they were expected to observe. But Jesus did not interest himself in these matters. From childhood, he acted independently of the rabbinical laws. The scriptures of the Old Testament were his constant study, and the words, "Thus saith the Lord," were ever upon his lips. Now, shall we for a moment discuss the physiological or psychological basis for these Pharisees making these rigid rules upon the children and youth and the older people as well? Why did they do that? And there are a number of reasons. Firstly, when the children of Israel lost their connection with God, which they did, of course, some centuries before this, after they came back from Babylonian captivity and rebuilt the temple, at first under Ezra and Nehemiah they prospered, but sadly, it wasn't very long before they began to slip into deep, dark apostasy again. And when they lost their living connection with the God of heaven, they lost the spirit of obedience, and when they lost the spirit of obedience, then what naturally followed? Disobedience. Because when that spirit is gone, then disobedience comes. And of course the priest class, who depended upon the people for their financial support, began to see a fading away of the disposition on the part of the folk to bring in their tithes and offerings. Because naturally, of course, when you lose your connection with God, what happens to your support of God's work? It dies away too, doesn't it? And as the priests and rulers saw their financial base being undermined, they had to do something, of course, to restore that base once more. And that meant, of course, that they had to impose upon the people, in the absence of a spirit of obedience, they had to force them to do what in themselves they did not want to do. And of course, spiritual things are spiritually discerned, and it's impossible for an unspiritual person to keep the Sabbath, for instance, as a spiritual exercise. He does it because he is told to do it. And the unspiritual mind has to have very clear-cut black and white rules and regulations to govern his behavior. And as time went by, these priests added more and more and more of this, their primary objective being to maintain their own authority and to assure themselves of financial support. In other words, they had to become the masters of the people. They had to control those people. They had to direct what they did in order to maintain their authority. So when Jesus Christ came along and refused to respect that authority and would not come under their rules and regulations, would not do what they said, how do you suppose this affected the scribes and Pharisees? Were they happy about it?
No, I'm angry.
They're angry about it because they recognized a threat to the system by which they maintained their power and authority. And of course that meant, of course, their day-by-day financial support. So we can recognize the fact then that this disposition on Christ's part, not to obey them but to obey his Heavenly Father, this position on Christ's part to always ask the question, thus, or to make the statement rather, thus saith the Lord, and to spend his time studying the scriptures of the Old Testament, was something which the Pharisees regarded as being a threat to their authority, and therefore they began to put pressure upon Jesus Christ to come under their authority in the place of God's authority. Now let's diagram this on the board this morning as follows. Here we find that we have the God of heaven, and Jesus Christ, even as a child and a boy, looked to God as the only plan maker in his life, the only one that he would respect in this connection, and he would obey human beings only when their requirements corresponded to God's requirements. Now, out here were the rulers in the Commonwealth of Israel, and they did their level best to bring Christ under their authority, so they strove to put themselves in over Jesus Christ in the place of God over Jesus Christ. So when they tried to make themselves God in the place of God over Jesus Christ, then what were they literally building?
Papacy.
The papacy, right? Or Babylon, or the Antichrist. Now Jesus Christ had come to destroy the Babylonian system, and he would not under any circumstances bow to that kind of pressure, and neither must we under any circumstances. Right, now let's just read a little further. As the condition of the people began to open to his mind, he saw that the requirements of society and the requirements of God were in constant collision. Men were departing from the word of God and exalting theories of their own invention. They were observing traditional rites that possessed no virtue. Their service was a mere round of ceremonies. The sacred truths it was designed to teach were hidden from the worshippers. He saw that in their faithless services they found no peace. They did not know the freedom of spirit that would come to them by serving God in truth. Jesus had come to teach the meaning of the worship of God, and he could not sanction the mingling of human requirements and with the divine precepts. He did not attack the precepts or practices of the learned teachers, but when reproved for his own simple habits, he presented the word of God in justification of his conduct. Now I greatly appreciate Christ's technique in obeying the word of God. You see, he did not make a direct attack upon the precepts and practices of the learned rabbis and teachers of Israel. In other words, he did not adopt the role of critic or of accuser or of condemner, but instead he presented the positive virtues of obedience and faith, doing God's will, and when they called upon him to give up his loyalty to God and come into subjection to them, then he simply quoted the scriptures to justify the course of action he had pursued. Now Satan is the accuser of the brethren, and we must face the fact, of course, that the accusations of Satan are all too often all too true. In fact, in the parable of Joshua and the angel found in Zechariah the 3rd chapter, we have there a picture of Satan standing by as the accuser, and he's referred to as the accuser in Revelation chapter 12, right? He accused him before God day and night. And in the Great Controversy, and also Testimonies volume 5, prophets and kings, where they're told that Satan has an accurate knowledge of the sin which he has caused them to commit, to their real offenses, and he presents these before God's people in the hope that he will discourage them by the memory of their past sins. Now, people tend to think that if their accusations are true against a church or a people, that they have a divine right to make those accusations. But God's people are not accusers, whether the accusation be truthful or false. Satan is the accuser, and most of his accusations are what? True or false? They're quite true. Does the fact that they're quite true justify his role as the accuser? No, it doesn't. Christ said to the woman taken in adultery, "Neither do I condemn thee, go and sin no more." And there is no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, as you read in Romans chapter 8 and verse 1. And I greatly appreciate the technique or the approach of Christ here, in that he did not make an attack upon or level accusations at the erroneous system adopted by the scribes and Pharisees. Instead, he lived a righteous life in the face of these erroneous principles, and then when they came to him and said, "Why do you do this?" he said, "Because the Bible says to." He didn't say the Bible condemned what you're doing. He simply says, "The Bible tells me to do this, and I'm doing it." And of course, his life then, shining into the darkness around about him, certainly exposed the error that was being taught in those places. Now, there have been a lot of movements arise up in the last 20 or 30 years here in North America, Canada, and especially in the United States of America, just south of the border. And you'll notice that a characteristic of all those movements has been, first and foremost, accusation. Isn't that right?
Yes.
They'll write whole pages and pages about what the Seventh-day Adventist Church is doing, and so on. Now, name one of those movements that survived for more than 10 or 15 years. There are some who haven't had time yet to die yet, but they will die. And name one of them which survives, can you? They all die, don't they? Every one of them fades off the scene and disappears. And by their accusations, what do they really achieve anyway? Nothing. Nothing at all. Now, if you think back over the message God has given to us over the years, the character of God, the seven angels and so forth, how much time do we waste during camp time accusing other church organizations? How much time? None at all. What are we concerned about? Great positive truth. We're concerned about what does God say in his word, and what is the result? This is the only movement of all those little movements which have sprung up, which is today belting the world. All the others are confined to most of their own home country. Some do have an outreach to one overseas country, perhaps. But this message, of course, is belting the world and growing vigorously and strongly year after year after year, whereas the others have all faded away and died. And Satan, to the accuser of the brethren, is likewise going to fade away and die and disappear out of the universe, because that kind of spirit, which is the spirit of the destroyer, not the spirit of the healer, is going to cause his ultimate and total destruction. And the very accusations he levels against God's people and the very sentences he passes upon God's people are going to be shared by himself. And of course, we make a distinction here between criticizing and accusing people and churches for what they do on the one side, and examining false doctrine upon the other side. Now, we're plainly told in the scriptures to try the spirits, determine what a man is teaching, to see whether what he teaches is a plain thus saith the Lord. If we didn't do that, how can we even know which church to belong to, what message to believe in? And the answer would be, we couldn't possibly. So while we do not accuse folk for what they do, we do, of course, examine and evaluate the teachings of various church bodies, so we'll know where to stand ourselves, what to reject and what to believe. And I greatly appreciate Christ's technique in this respect. We're moving a little further now. Page 85. In every gentle and submissive way, Jesus tried to please those with whom he came in contact. Because he was so gentle and unobtrusive, the scribes and elders supposed that he would be easily influenced by their teaching. They urged him to receive the maxims and traditions that had been handed down from the ancient rabbis, but he asked for their authority in Holy Writ. He would hear every word that proceeds from the mouth of God, but he could not obey the inventions of men. Jesus seemed to know the scriptures from beginning to end, and he presented them in their true import. The rabbis were ashamed to be instructed by a child. They claimed that there was their office to explain the scriptures, and that it was his place to accept their interpretation. They were indignant that he should stand in opposition to their words. Now come back to this thought in regard to the answer which Christ gave to the Pharisees. It says they urged him to receive the maxims and traditions that had been handed down from the ancient rabbis, but he asked for their authority in Holy Writ. He would hear every word that proceeds from the mouth of God, but he could not obey the inventions of men. Now we're looking, of course, for the manifestation of Christ as a holy one. And what is one of the specifications for holiness? Living by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So Jesus Christ, first of all, knew that word. As the statement says, he seemed to know the Bible from beginning to end. The Bible back in those days, of course, being Genesis to Malachi, right? They didn't have Matthew, Mark, Luke and John and down to Revelation then. And he knew the Old Testament very, very well indeed. He could quote text after text after text. And when they came to him and said, now look, young fellow, you ought to be doing this. You don't show the respect you should to the Pharisees and the leaders. You should be doing this. He'd say, well, very quietly and gently, that's a very interesting requirement. Now, but tell me, where do you read that in the chapter and verse? Where do you read it? And of course they couldn't find the chapter and verse necessary to impose upon him their authority. They might quote, of course, certain scriptures perhaps, or misquote them I should better say, but he would say, yes, but that scripture doesn't really mean that, and that's proved by the fact that this scripture over here, which illumines that scripture, says so and so. And can't you imagine the frustration and the rage which must have possessed those men when Christ met them in this fashion? So gentle, so unassuming. There was no trace of a spirit of disobedience, and yet he disobeyed, didn't they? There was no trace of a spirit of disobedience, and yet he disobeyed. Because the spirit of obedience causes a person to obey God's word, to follow God's directions and plans, and to disobey anything contrary to that. So Christ did have a spirit of disobedience too, in a certain very, very special sense, which kind of spirit we also have to have, in that we shall not do anything excepting we have a plain thus saith the Lord to support our actions. So then, Jesus Christ then was a holy child, a holy youth, as he determined that he would obey only that which came to him as by way of a plain thus saith the Lord. And when a plain thus saith the Lord was not there, then he would not obey the commands of the scribes and the Pharisees. Now, as we shall learn in our next study period, that this brought upon Christ tremendous pressure from those men. Those men did their very, very best to try and force him to give up his allegiance to God and to respect them in the place of God. But our time has gone for this study, please, we'll have to stop at this point. Right, any questions you'd like to ask on this presentation this morning? Very good, let's take a closing hymn then.